And I just keep coming back to this magnificent steering. It is the most communicative in this class.
Hey crew, I've got the key to that 22 Alfa Romeo Giulia Veloce. It's the only time I'll say it that way, I promise. We are gonna take it for a drive, but first, let's check out how it looks on the inside and outside. Up front, we find a very expressive face with the V-shaped Alfa grille, gaining black accenting on the Veloce model. There's functional cooling at the lower bumpers, including brake ducts right there. There are LED DRLs and turn signals, but by xenon headlights, not LEDs. This gold paint job is called Orca GT Tricoat, and it reminds me a lot of the Acura TLX's Tiger Eye Pearl. At the side, you as standard get 18-inch wheels. This one has upgraded 19-inch alloys with the 5-hole punch design. They're wrapped in Pirelli all-season tires, 225 section front and rear. Within those wheels are red-painted brakes. You get Brembo 4 pistons up front. There's a Veloce badge here. Black gloss for the mirror caps and window trim. Stepping back to look at the profile, it's a very handsome, curvy silhouette with two hard creases. I like the wheels with this body. And at the back are LED taillights and turn signals. This Q4 badge signifies it's the all-wheel drive model. And down low is a blacked out Veloce specific diffuser with two blacked out exhaust finishers. Overall, I'm enamored with the Giulia's design, though I don't think I would go with this paint job. What do you guys think? Is this better or worse looking than a new BMW 3 Series? Let me know in the comments. And let's check out the interior. Opening up and looking inside at this black interior with leather seating, seat perforations, and rear seat heating, plus a secondary sunroof on Veloce. This one is optional leather for the door panel toppers with contrast stitching. Injection molding is here. More leather with padding for the armrests. You get one-touch up-down windows, hard plastics down low, and an optional 14-speaker Harman Kardon sound system. Stepping in, beyond my own seat at 6 feet tall, I've got enough but not abundant knee room. Seat backs in hard plastics. The mat pockets are netted and wear out really easily. The foot pockets are kind of narrow to slide my feet under. Thigh support isn't great. Headroom is okay. So my head's kind of nestled against the roof with my head back on the headrest. If I kind of slouch a bit, then it's more comfortable, but I'm just not really relaxed back here. There are two, look at these things, they're like bugging out at me. I can't unsee that really. Two air vents, two USB-A ports, and the drive shaft hump is very large with a narrow alley, so getting into the middle is tough. And then the seat itself is raised up, so I just don't have headroom. Maybe you stick a kid in the middle, or maybe you just put no one there. If you have no one, then an armrest comes down with leather padding and two cup holders. So the back seats of the Giulia Veloce are pretty nice, with like a third zone of climate and not that face, and maybe a little more headroom. Let's check out the front. Door close noise. It's a quality thud. Doesn't quite have the same sound absorption as some German sedans, but it's good. Smart keyless entry for the front two doors. These front sport bucket seats get the Alfa Romeo crests on them, front seat heating, power adjusting side bolsters, manual thigh extensions, and three position memory. You also get your own sunroof, front passengers enjoy. There are aluminum accents for the foot pedals and tread plates. Hit this button to pop up the trunk lid, and it does come all the way up. I like that. Inside, we find 13 cubic feet of space. Not bad, but not class leading. Pull these two tabs to pop down the rear seats 40-20-40. It strikes me as kind of odd that there isn't a spare donut or even a fix-a-flat kit under the floor. We have these built-in handles to close the trunk lid. Materials on the front doors are the same as the back, including this textured aluminum trim. We have power adjusting and power folding door mirrors. In the driver's seat, throw the vehicle in accessory mode to turn on the digital TFT display in between an analog speedo and tachometer. A lot of new cars moving to fully digital instrument clusters, at least like the font and design of this analog setup and the 3D effect to the gauge housing. No head-up display, stitched leather up on the dashboard as an option. And here we have an 8-inch touchscreen infotainment system that's kind of sluggish, and the graphics are last generation. We do have wired Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Beneath the screen are physical HVAC controls. You've got a USB-A port and DC outlet, two cup holders, lots of that aluminum trim, which I'm glad to see, instead of gloss black. They kept that to a minimum here and here. The gear selector is substantial and leather wrapped. You've got the tricolor Italian flag here, this secondary dial controlling your infotainment system, which has navigation as standard for 22. Wireless smartphone charging slot here, also new and standard for 22. Leather wrapping for the armrest, and inside we find just a little bit of storage with a USB-A and C port plus an aux jack. Visibility is excellent, and you have standard blind spot monitoring and rear cross traffic for 22. I really like this cabin. The seats feel great and the leather looks exquisite. I like the aluminum details, and the steering wheel is beautiful with the leather wrapping, the grips at 9 and 3, perfect thickness in the hands, and giant aluminum paddles on the back look super sporty. I just feel like the infotainment system and gauge cluster are looking dated and the back passenger room is somewhat confined. Let's take the Giulia Veloce for a drive now. All right, let's fire it up with the button on the wheel. Why is this so cool? The dials turn over, we get our chimes, and then an animation of the Alfa Romeo logo on the infotainment screen, and we're live. Our drive mode is selected here via the DNA controller. And D stands for dynamic, N for natural, and A for advanced efficiency. They just put A. We're gonna start out in natural, and then we pull the toggle on the back of the gear selector and click it forward to go into reverse. That brings up a low resolution backup camera system, and we do have trajectory lines. The camera just takes up this portion of the screen, and on the left, we've got parking sensors. No bird's eye view or other camera angles to choose from. It's down into drive. And we will begin with a turning radius test. Where the Giulia shows kind of a wide arc there. For this size of sedan, I feel like the BMW 3 Series turned tighter. To operate the turn signals, it's a fixed position stock. So you click all the way up to keep it going, or just do a half click for those three indications. And then to make it go off, you do a half click down. Here's what that sounds like. It's not abrasive. World famous horn test is up next. Yes, my goodness. That is plenty loud. The sound just carries. Powertrain in all Giulia trims except for the range-topping Quadrifoglio is a 2.0-liter turbocharged four-cylinder that makes 280 horsepower and 306 pound-feet of torque. That is class-leading power and torque, and it's routed through an 8-speed automatic gearbox to your choice of rear drive as standard, or as this one is equipped with the all-wheel drive package, all four tires. Accessing that power in the natural drive mode, is pretty traditional turbocharger. By that I mean that you've got to put your foot fairly far into the throttle
build up the revs, and then the turbocharger spools and the power just kind of swells up. It's not a perfectly linear delivery like some twin turbocharged setups or naturally aspirated motors. When you are up to speed, cruising is a gentle task. The Giulia Veloce uses a fixed damper setup. Their sport suspension. Adaptive dampers are available, though not equipped to this vehicle. And the ride is pretty taut. You get jostled around quite a bit in these seats. It's not punishing in any real way. You can feel the absorption of the suspension when you go over bumps. But you do get moved around. The seats themselves, over the distance I've traveled in them, which have been up to an hour of seat time, have remained comfortable. They're supportive, well cushioned, and contour nicely to my body with these adjustable side bolsters, giving you some leeway if you're a larger man or woman. The brake pedal takes a little while to build up the sensitivity to it, because you feel like if you're giving it consistent pressure, at some point in time it gets a little bitier, and so it brings you down to a stop more quickly. I feel like over time, I'd adjust. You can kind of eke out a little bit of turbocharger induction noise, that's kind of fun. And the rumble from the exhaust is there. Let's see if the Giulia Veloce is quick to 60 next. For such a task, I've got my race box set up here, and we're going to move into the dynamic setting. I went down into advanced. Dynamic, there we go. That little graphic on the infotainment. Then from here, I need to turn off the start-stop system. And I'm going to hold my foot hard on the brake. There is no launch control system. And then I'm going to pin the throttle and let go of the brake. There it is, in 5.8 seconds. You can feel the kick of each gear change in dynamic. Now, I expected a little quicker than that. Yes, this is a real-world test. We were facing a little bit of an uphill. I hadn't warmed the tires perfectly. But with an all-wheel drive system, I was anticipating in the low to mid 5-second range. That's what its competitors are seeing with even less power. But we got 5.8. Thankfully, a slower than expected 0 to 60 isn't the whole story on this Giulia's performance, because when you put your foot down, you get to feel that extra power that this car has in this segment. The downshift doesn't take a whole lot of time, and then in dynamic it holds on to that gear, so the turbocharger stays spooled. And if we are to try out manual mode, click over on the gear selector and use these giant, tempting paddles. I mean, for a car like this to have paddles like this, you'd think you'd be in the Quadrifoglio, but no. I like the downshifts. They are prompt. Down and up. Get some quick shifts. And the Giulia becomes very entertaining to drive. Gosh, I love the action of pulling the paddles too. They're not just big, but the travel engages you as the driver. Let's check in on the handling next. Velocity's there. and this chassis feels energized. The steering is quick and light, easy to point the car, and then the chassis is just playful in the way it just darts in there as well. Brakes are nice and bitey. Scrub that speed. This is far more entertaining than I expected it to be. Goodness, I like this car. I really do. The dynamics are just delightful. The body is super composed, meaning that the tuning of the suspension is very well dialed. The brakes have that sharpness to them. The all-wheel drive system gets the power down with the limited slip rear differential that you have with this package. In control of itself over crests, and I just keep coming back to this magnificent steering. It is the most communicative in this class. And even on these all-season tires, you can have a blast. I was going to give this car flack for not being able to turn off the traction and stability control system, but I have yet to see it really interfere with me enjoying the car. Even the engine note isn't half bad. It doesn't sound whiny like these engines can. It's got a little charisma there. I feel like now, as we go into the advanced efficiency drive mode, we can assign a miles per hour word of the day to the 22 Giulia Veloce. And that word is fervent, meaning intense or enthusiastic. And I feel like that's the persona this car takes on. Nice Healy. As soon as you go into the dynamic setting, it just wakes up and becomes very excitable and fun and engaging. And that I feel like in the sports sedan segment isn't lacking necessarily. Like the BMW 330 is a really good to drive car, but this just adds this energy level above that of the 330 that makes it something you want to seek out those roads. And before we jump into direct pricing and competition, a couple things I've yet to share with you. The fuel economy of the Giulia is 23 mpg in the city, 31 on the highway, and 26 combined. The top speed is 149 miles per hour. The starting figure for the Giulia Sprint is just under $45,000. If you want the Veloce, you're looking at about 50 grand. And this one is tested, it's just under $58,000. That price would be a problem because now you're into the BMW M340i territory, and that's just in a different class. But if you go for the mid or mid-high trim level of the Giulia and you add on the performance pack, which gives you the limited slip differential and the adaptive dampers, now you're looking at high 40s, and there's good performance for dollar there, because what it really competes against there is the BMW 330i. That vehicle starts at $45,000 for the xDrive version, the all-wheel drive version. It makes 255 horsepower. It gets to 60 in 5.1 seconds, and the fuel economy is 29 combined. You also have the Audi A4. We look at the 45 trim, and that one starts at $43,000. It makes 261 horsepower. It gets to 60 in a scant 4.9 seconds, and the fuel economy is 27 combined. So that means that the Giulia, while making class-leading horsepower and torque, does not have the quickest to 60 and has the worst fuel economy in all-wheel drive flavor. Is it not the best buy, though? Well, let's think about things I don't love about it, and they're actually very few. For one, the infotainment system is not the highest resolution, doesn't have the best graphics, but I think there's actually an update for that for 23. No digital gauge cluster, actually doesn't bother me. I like the analog gauges. The rear passenger space isn't abundant, but it's not so confined that it would be terribly uncomfortable for full-size adults. Everything else is magnificent. I love the look of this interior. The driving dynamics are a cut above when compared to the 330 and when compared to the A4. And that's why I think I would choose this. I just would probably keep it to 50,000 or under to feel like I'm getting a great value. Oh, I didn't show you the adaptive cruise control feature and the lane keep assist, which are now standard for 22. This one also has a traffic jam assist that is an option and will work hands-free at speeds up to like 35 miles per hour. I hope you guys have enjoyed this POV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel, hit that bell to get notified, and I'll see you next time.